this men of old. As with gladness men of old did the guiding star behold, as with joy they hailed its light, leading onward beaming bright, so most gracious Lord may we to that lowly manger bed, there to bend the knee before Him whom heaven and earth adore. So may we with willing feet ever seek Thy mercy seat. To Thee, our heavenly King. Holy Jesus, every day keep us in the narrow way. And when earthly things are past, bring our ransomed souls at last.
Okay. And I think it has actually the very same thing. It's very close. So if you didn't get it the first time, you'll get it the second time.
Once in Amen.
next one is Joyful, Joyful. That'll be our opening song, so if you'll stand for that, we'll sing Joyful, Joyful. Or is it Joy by and by? Number 12.
You'll see the regular announcements on your bulletin there, and I have an additional one here today. It's concerning the Chapel Oaks Church, and it will host a special revival and training for pastors and other interested persons, and the guest speaker will be Don McClafferty. It's being provided free of charge, and it's January 10th through 17th at 9 a.m. through 3 p.m. daily. And they have some additional things for children and the evenings. So you might want to, if you want more information on this, just contact myself or one of the other elders. At this time, I think Rob has something to say.
Good morning, everybody. I just wanted to bring it to your attention once again. Today is the cutoff date for the devotionals for this next year. So if you're dragging your feet and couldn't make a decision if whether you wanted to get a devotional for 2024, it's time to make the decision. All right, go ahead and get this on order. So I need to have, if you are still interested in getting a devotional, I've had a few people put their names on the list out there. I'll need to have you put your names down today, and payment needs to be market for devotionals. And if you're wondering what you can get, if I have a few more print-offs of this, if anybody would like one, just raise your hand and I'll give you one. And like I say, just turn in your funds and we'll get your books on order. I look at placing the order on Monday. This one here, this is $18. All right, so if you're interested in it, like I say, today is the last day. All right, thank you.
So I believe at this time we'll have our children's story.
Good morning and happy Sabbath. Before we get started, I would like for you to turn in your Bibles, you older children, to 1 Timothy chapter 6. 1 Timothy chapter 6. And we're going to start kind of in the middle of verse 11. O man of God, or woman of God, child of God, follow after righteousness, godliness, faith, love, patience, meekness. Fight the good fight of faith. Lay hold on eternal life, whereunto thou art also called, and hast professed a good profession before many witnesses. All right. I think 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse in the middle of 11 and then 12. Okay, so Isaiah is going to help me today. Isaiah. Okay, Isaiah, you're a sinner, right? You're a sinner, yes. Okay, and kind of turn around. This is his load of sin that he's carrying. We're all sinners, right? Yeah. And it's heavy, isn't it?
Way heavy.
Way heavy. All right. Let's just see what kind of sins, what kind of weight little Isaiah is carrying. Now, Isaiah is representing each one of us. Okay. Fighting. Okay. Praying to idols. In other words, having something before God as first in your life. Selfishness, stealing, still heavy, right? Yes.
Still heavy.
Disobeying. Well, here's a cursing. Isaiah. Oh, lies. Still heavy? Q. killing. Okay. You're carrying this weight, right? Yeah. It's starting to be very heavy. Okay. Do you know that there's a way that we can get rid of this heavy load? You know?
No.
Jesus says, come unto me. Come unto me. All ye that are, all you that have a heavy laden, and lay it down at Jesus' feet. Lay it down at Jesus' feet. Come up here, Isaiah. Okay, we laid your burden of sin. Turn around here. We laid your burden of sin down at Jesus' feet, right?
Yes.
How do you feel now?
Much more lighter.
Much more lighter. The burden of sin is gone when we lay it at Jesus' feet. Now, Isaiah, I'm going to ask you a question. We didn't practice this part. Would you like to carry that heavy a load all your life? No?
No.
Okay, so if we lay our burden of sin down at Jesus' feet, we don't want to pick it back up, do we? No. Okay, you get it? A little child, right? A little child understands sin is not something that you want to carry. You want to lay that down at Jesus' feet. You want to cultivate, with Jesus' help, those things that are mentioned in the Bible. Love, joy, peace, faith, goodness, kindness, all of those good things, right? Right. Don't pick that big burden back up. Never. Don't pick it up. Leave it at Jesus' feet. That's why he died for us, right? When Isaiah and I were kind of practicing this morning, when I first put that on, it touched my heart what he said. I said, how does it feel? He said, it feels like the weight of the whole world's sins are on my shoulders. On you, yes. Yes. But Jesus said, I already took that burden. You don't have to carry it anymore. Yeah, not at all. All right. So I don't have the total, and I kind of looked in the box for our total for our 13th Sabbath mission offering, and I didn't see that they didn't put it on the top where I could see it right away. So I'm not sure what our total was from last week, but now is your opportunity to bring your 13th Sabbath mission offering up and be a part of this program. So come on up. Thank you, Isaiah, for leading the way. Bring your offering up if you... I don't know if you can see what I see, but look, it's over the top. It's so awesome. Thank you so much for being part of the program this morning. Thank you so much for bringing your offering. to help spread the good news that Jesus died for every single person in this world so that they could have eternal life. Because there are still some that haven't heard that good news. Let's bow our heads for prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we're so very thankful for this beautiful Sabbath day that you've given to us. Thank you for Jesus, your Son, who loved us so much that he gave his life to bear the price of our sins, pay the price for our sins, and died on the cross for us, so that we could be raised to new life, eternal life, when he comes again. In Jesus' name we pray.
Father in heaven, we thank you for this sunshiny day. And Lord, we know because of the righteousness of Jesus, we can also have sunshine in our hearts. At this time, Father, invoke your Holy Spirit upon this congregation. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. People come in all shapes and sizes, and so do their needs. The offering today is Adventist Community Services. And there was a man named David that walked into it's called Joseph's Storehouse Food Pantry. And it's an Adventist Community Center in Oklahoma. Adventist Community Service Center in Oklahoma. So the staff soon learned that David had some needs. He had just gotten out of prison. He was living in a tent down by the river. And so when he came in, they gave him some basic things and food, of course. And the food he would take would be food that was already just ready to eat, because he didn't have anything to cook with. And so one of the volunteers noticed this, and so he gathered up a small stove, a can opener, and some other items there that would enable David to cook. And so soon David was a regular there, and the center continues to assist him. Now he's trying to save money to buy a house. And so this should be a great help to him. In the book Ministry of Healing, page 143, it says, "The Savior mingled with men as one who desired their good. He showed his sympathy for them, ministered to their needs, and won their confidence. Then he bade them follow me." Will the deacons please stand? So Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for for all you've done for us. We thank you for the community centers that help people. May each and every one of us be mindful of the needs of others and ask you daily what we can do for them. And we know that you will guide us and that these people will be helped and that Jesus, our goal is that Jesus might be seen and that he loves them and died to save them from their sins. We ask your blessing now upon the tithes and offerings for their intended use. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. It's time now for our intercessory prayer, and as far as possible, shall we kneel? Heavenly Father, we know the eight nations are angry, and we know by this that your coming is soon. Our prayer is that we might be ready, you might seal your people for that great event. And Lord, those all around us now, we have people who are sick. Frances Campbell, we ask you would be with her, comfort her. Cindy Bolajack, also sick. And we ask for prayer, special prayer for Margaret Hamlet's family and Betty Gerke's family. Lord, we have a request for that you would be involved in the decision of our Slavic pastor, our Sunday church that is now meeting here, and that you would guide him in his decision. We know that Robert Eppel's one of his tenants that accepted the Sabbath. His tenant has cancer now, so we ask your that you would comfort him and according to your perfect will heal him. And today this week our focus of prayer is Henry and Rena Dixon. So Lord, we just thank you for all these people and that you will watch over them. Pray now in Jesus' name. Amen.
I have found a friend in Jesus. He's everything to me. He's the fairest of 10,000s to my soul. The lily of the valley, in him alone I see. All I need to cleanse and make me fully whole. In so
my comfort in troubles. He's my friend. He tells me every care on him to roll. The lily of the valley, the bright and morning star, he's the fairest of 10,000s to my soul. He will never, never leave me, nor yet forsake me here, while I live by faith and do his blessed will. A wall of fire about me, I've nothing now to fear. With his manna, he my hungry soul shall fill. Then sweeping up in glory, I'll see his blessed face, where rivers of delight shall ever roll. He's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the greatest of 10,000s to my soul.
Heaven, we just ask now that you send your Holy Spirit upon the speaker, Darrin, today, and that you might guide his words by your Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. The scripture reading for this morning is from Isaiah chapter 66, verses 1 and 2. Make a joyful noise unto God, all ye lands. Sing forth the honor of his name. Make his praise glorious. May the Lord bless the reading.
Good morning. Blessings to everybody. I can't tell if I'm on. Okay. Sounds like I'm on now. Okay, I thought it was me. I thought I'd mess this up. Before I get started, I want to come to you on behalf of the prayer ministries. We have a prayer call Monday through Friday at 6:30, and everybody is welcome to join. And a couple things we prayed about here recently. Last week, Rachel from the Gladstone Church, she said, I've been doing Bible studies with this girl, but she stopped, and I'd really like for us to keep having Bible studies. So we prayed about it. Right afterwards, 30 minutes later, she got a call from the lady saying, I want to start having Bible studies again. Sean was having some business needs, and we spent a lot of time praying about that. Things got taken care of. The Lord is answering prayer, and we invite the whole church, just call in one day a week. That's all you have to do. Call in one day a week and pray with us, and you don't even have to pray out loud. Just pray silently. Let's pray. Father, I pray that you will give me the words to say to your people and give them ears to hear what you want them to hear. In Jesus' name, amen. Open your Bibles to Psalms chapter 66. And then also in your bulletin, there's some Bible verses that you will need. I've got an extra one here that, believe it or not, I don't need. Anybody need one? Okay. All right. Psalm 66, right in the middle of your Bible, or if you're like me, it's just a click or two here, and you're right there. Psalm 66, and the title of my message is Psalm 66. You can tell I spend hours agonizing over the titles of my sermons. Verse 1 and 2, as Roger read, Psalm 66 is, make a joyful noise unto God, all ye lands. Sing forth the honor of his name, make his praise glorious. Everybody's invited to know God. Everybody's invited to praise God. Everybody's invited here to have a joyful spirit and learn to love God and learn to cherish God. Life can be hard sometimes. It can be. Life can be really hard sometimes.
But God calls on his people to rejoice in him and praise. Sing praise. 1 Thessalonians 5:16 and 18. Rejoice evermore. 18. In everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. In everything we are called upon to give thanks. Now that doesn't mean, oh, thank you, God, I just totaled out the car. The other guy doesn't have insurance. And that doesn't mean, thank you, God, I just fell down the steps and broke both legs. But look for reasons to thank God. Look for reasons to praise God. When life gets hard, and it does. When life gets really hard, and it does. Praise God. Thank God. Worship God. In 1 John 2:2, speaking of Jesus. And he is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. Now that's a reason to rejoice. That's a reason to praise God, knowing that Jesus has died for every person's sins. He's died for my sins. No matter how bad it is, I've got a reason to rejoice. I've got a reason to praise God. In John 3:16, maybe you already know this one, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. There's better days ahead. No matter how bad it is for you, there's better days ahead. Verse 3. Say unto God, how terrible art thou in thy works, or how awesome art thou in thy works. Through the greatness of thy power shall thy enemies submit themselves unto thee. He talks about the enemies submitting themselves unto God, not out of thankfulness, of course, not out of rejoicing and praise, but because they have no choice. God wins. Jesus wins. When all is said and done, God will win. Now, that may not look like it now. And certainly in the days ahead, it's not going to look like it. But when all is said and done, God will win. If you remember your history books, back in 1939, it looked like the Nazis, the Germans, were going to win. No doubt about it. 1940, absolutely they were going to win. 1941, 1942, well, we're not so sure. When all was said and done, they didn't win. And it may at times look like God is not going to win, but when all is said and done, God wins, Jesus wins, and his people win with him. In 1 Corinthians 15:24, then cometh the end, when he shall have delivered up the kingdom to God, even the Father, when he shall have put down all rule and all authority and power, verse 25, for he must reign till he hath put all enemies under his feet. God the Father sets up God the Son to deal with the rebels and deal with rebellion. And we talk about the love of God, and praise God for his love. And we talk about the mercy of God, and we praise God for his mercy. But for those who choose not to accept his love or his mercy, justice here has to be served. It has to be served. The enemies need to submit themselves unto him. Now, I remember growing up, sometimes my dad wanted me to do some things, and I really didn't want to do them. Now, my dad wasn't a religious man, but he seemed to believe in Ephesians 6:14, the belt of truth, if you know what I'm talking about. And because of that, I submitted myself unto him. And enemies need to submit themselves unto God. The wisest thing anybody can do is choose to submit themselves to love and serve Jesus Christ, because when all is said and done, they win. Everybody wins who's linked up with Christ. Verse 4. All the earth shall worship thee, and shall sing unto thee. They shall sing to thy name. When all is said and done, there will be people everywhere praising God. There will be people from Indonesia. There will be people from Africa. Where'd Chuck Wooson go? There will be people from Europe, and believe it or not, there'll be people from America, worshiping and praising God. When all is said and done, there'll be people from all walks of life, rich and poor and black and white and purple, everywhere, everybody, there will be people from all different categories. In Revelation 7, 9, and 10, this is at the end of time. And after this I beheld, and lo, a great multitude, which no man could number, of all nations and kindreds and people and tongues, stood before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed with white robes and palms in their hands. That's palms of victory, palm branches of victory. And cried with a loud voice, saying, salvation to our God, which sitteth upon the throne, and unto the Lamb. The saved of all ages are gathered together before the throne of God and the throne of Christ. And they're in white robes, covered with the righteousness of Christ. The palm branches of victory, because God has given them the victory. There will be millions, hundreds of millions of people there, singing and worshiping and praising. Unfortunately, there will be billions who won't be there. There will be billions of people who could have been there. They had every chance. They had every opportunity. And for whatever reason, they chose not to give their heart to Jesus Christ. We got to make sure we give our heart to Jesus Christ. We got to love him and serve him. In John 12, 32, Jesus says, and I, if I be lifted up from the earth, will draw all men unto me. The Holy Spirit is working right now. The Holy Spirit is working on hearts right now, working on hearts, working on lives, trying to draw us to him so we can go to heaven, we can go home with him. But he doesn't force. God's not going to force anybody kicking and screaming into heaven. We have to choose, yeah, I want to be there. We have to decide, yeah, I'm going to wholeheartedly give my heart to Christ. Don't let money keep you out of heaven. Don't let fame or fortune or wealth or people come between you and Christ. Give your heart totally to him. In Mark 8, 36, 37. But what shall it profit a man if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? What profit is there if we turn out to be Bill Gates? Now, we got so much money and so much power and so much influence, but we miss out on heaven. What profit is it if we turn out to be a great movie star or a great musician and everybody loves us and they say we're so great and wonderful, but we miss out on heaven? What does it profit us? But we got to be honest. Most people, they're not trading heaven to be a billionaire. They're trading heaven for a few dollars, trading heaven to be strung out on drugs. Trading heaven to be pregnant outside of marriage. They could have had heaven. They could have had eternal life. And how many are trading that for something that, when all said and done, they wish they didn't have? Jesus is striving to save us, striving to get us into heaven. In verse 4 here, again, says they're singing to his name. Now, many times in the Bible, the name represents the character. So they're singing about the character of Christ. In Exodus 34, 5-7. And the Lord descended in the cloud and stood with him there and proclaimed the name of the Lord. And the Lord passed by before him and proclaimed, the Lord God, merciful and gracious, long-suffering, and abundant in goodness and truth, keeping mercy for thousands and forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin, and that will by no means clear the guilty. He proclaims the name of God, the character of God, merciful and gracious to those who don't deserve it, and that's us. Not a one of us deserves the mercy. Not a one of us deserves the graciousness. That's why he's so merciful. Now, there are people today, and their thought is, all right, Jesus, I'll come to you, and I'll let you save me, but I call the shots. You know, I'm going to work where I want. I'm going to live where I want. I'm going to do what I want. And it doesn't work like that. We come to God, and we realize there's things he may ask me to do. He might tell me, I need you to work over here. I want you to live over here. I've got things I need you to do. So we realize as we come to Christ, He's our Lord. He's our Lord. He has the right to tell us what to do. It says here He's long-suffering. Look how long this world's gone on for. It's amazing what God has put up with. You think about the time of Noah. He gave him 120 years. 120 years. You think about when Israel went down into Egyptian captivity. It was 400 years. He said, the iniquity of the Amorites is not yet full. He gave those people 400 years to repent, and they didn't repent. He's so long-suffering. He's merciful. He's given us plenty of time, all the time that we need to repent. He says here His goodness, His forgiveness to those who are willing to turn from their sins. God is willing to forgive. He's merciful and gracious to those of us who don't deserve it. But then He says in verse 7, He will not clear the guilty. Those who refuse to come to Him, well, justice has to be served. Now, the saved. Ultimately, when all is said and done, the saved, they're not in heaven because heaven's so wonderful, because heaven's so great and fantastic, but because they've given their heart to Jesus Christ. They've chosen they're going to love Him, they've chosen they're going to serve Him, and that's ultimately why they make it. In 1 John 4:19, we love Him because He first loved us. That's the only way we can love Him, because He extended the hand of love unto us, and He called us unto Him, and He wants to save us and get us into heaven. Romans 2:4. Or despisest thou the riches of His goodness and forbearance and longsuffering, not knowing that the goodness of God leadeth thee to repentance? It's the goodness of God that leads people to repent. Now, ultimately here, it's not wrong to come to God because you hear about heaven and you want heaven, you want to live forever. It's not wrong to, well, I realize what a sinner I am and I'm going to be punished for my sins. So it's not wrong to come to God because you don't want to be punished for your sins. But ultimately what keeps us with God is here, Romans 2:4, when we see the goodness of God, especially in the face of Jesus Christ. When we see His goodness, His love, His mercy, as we allow our desire for heaven to be changed into great love for God, as we allow our fear of punishment and hellfire to be changed into great love and mercy towards God, we realize His love, His mercy, that's what keeps us with Jesus Christ. Just wanting heaven will never keep us with Him. Just being afraid of being punished will never keep us with Him. But as we team up with the Holy Spirit and allow Him to teach us how to love God, that's what keeps us with Him. That's what keeps us in heaven. Verse 5 and 6. Come and see the works of God. He is terrible, or He is awesome in His doing toward the children of men. He turned the sea into dry land. They went through the flood on foot. There did we rejoice in Him. When God works miracles, people rejoice. And He's talking about them when He brought Israel out of Egyptian captivity. God doesn't work miracles just to work miracles. Jesus never worked a miracle just to be working a miracle. It was always designed to win people's hearts. Ultimately, to win people to God. And you might remember, Jesus never did a mass healing. He never pulled everybody, thousands of sick people, into the temple and just raised His hands and healed them all at once. It was always one-on-one, trying to win their hearts. Yeah, heal them, but trying to win their hearts to God. That's what He's trying to do in our life, trying to win the heart. Anybody can say, yeah, I want heaven, or yeah, I'm afraid of that hot place, but He's trying to win the heart. He's trying to win the heart. In verse 6 here again, He's talking about the Red Sea in the Exodus, and you might remember, God brought Israel out of Egyptian captivity. They came up against the Red Sea. So the Red Sea's here, Israel's here. There's mountains on both sides, And then there's the Egyptian army coming at them. So it looked like they were trapped. There was no way out. They cried out to God, and God caused the east wind to blow that parted the water, and it dried up the mud. The wind dried up the mud. So when they went through it, they went through on dry ground. God thinks of everything. You know, if I did that, I would have said, well, let's part the sea. I would have forgot all about the mud. They would have gone through there. They all got stuck in the mud. Well, that wouldn't work. But God thinks of everything. He knows what he's doing. What's impossible with us is possible with God. What can't happen with me can happen with God. We team up with him, and we're seeking him with all the heart. He can do what I can't do. Verse 6 again. They rejoiced in God. When he brought them out of Egyptian captivity, they went through the Red Sea, they were rejoicing, they were praising and thanking God. But unfortunately, they didn't continue. You read the story, they were just murmuring and complaining. And Philippians 2:14. Do all things without murmuring and disputings. We are told not to sit around complaining. Not sit around murmuring and arguing and bickering with people. It ruins our faith. It absolutely ruins our faith. For Israel, they must have expected an easy, pain-free life. And then when trouble set in, all of a sudden they just forgot all about God's mercy and God's love, and they just started arguing and bickering. In 1 Peter 4:12, beloved, think it not strange concerning the fiery trial which is to try you as though some strange thing happened unto you. We are going to face trials. We are going to face tough times. We are going to get sick. We're going to get in traffic accidents. Things are going to happen to us that we don't like and we don't want. But I think we should ask the question, not why am I suffering, but how come I'm not suffering more? In a world where there's billions of demons that hate us, absolutely hate us, it's only God's mercy that protects us. If it wasn't for God, these demons would be tearing us apart. We're thankful. We should be thankful, rejoicing. Verse 7. He ruleth by his power forever. His eyes behold the nations. Let not the rebellious exalt themselves. It says his eyes behold the nations. Now, I remember growing up, and some of you might recall this. It seemed like our parents found out about things. How in the world they find out about that? Sometimes I find out things my kids have done. Don't always tell them, but we know it. How do they find out about that? Well, if parents can find out things like that, what about God? No, he sees everything. He knows everything. Proverbs 15:3. The eyes of the Lord are in every place, beholding the evil and the good. God sees everything, knows everything. Now, don't ask me to explain that. You know, I can't put together the molecules and the carbon and the oxygen and tell you why that is. I just know what the Bible says, and I trust it. God knows everything. God sees everything. He's aware of everything. And he says, rebellious, you need to stay in line. You need to stay in line. Sometimes the devil tries to point us to unbelievers, and, you know, they have all this success, and they've got all the girlfriends, and they're the popular ones, and all this. But how many unbelievers are, well, they're rotten in jail, no hope? How many unbelievers are homeless, no hope? How many unbelievers are in the hospital and they've got no hope? God's people have hope. No matter what we face, no matter what we go through, God's people have hope. He's always there for us. Romans 8:7. Because the carnal mind is enmity against God, for it's not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. Now this is the problem. The rebels are not subject to the law of God. They're not going to keep the law of God. Now they might agree with a few points. They might. They may not want to bow down and worship idols. They may not. But they don't agree with the whole law. And some people try to tell us, well, the law is done away with. But I guess they haven't read this verse here. Because the rebels, they do not keep the law. And God calls his children This is how to live. This is how we, as born-again Christians, this is how we're to live. Romans 8:13. For if ye live after the flesh, ye shall die. But if ye through the Spirit do mortify the deeds of the body, ye shall live. Takes the power of the Holy Spirit to live the way God calls us to live. As we tap into the power, we're reading our Bibles much. We tap into the power of God, we're praying much, we're asking for help. All of a sudden, the Holy Spirit kicks in. All of a sudden, the Holy Spirit helps us to do things that we can't do. Things that are impossible for us to do by ourselves, all of a sudden we call out to God and he gives us help and he gives us strength. You know, things that just can't happen by ourselves, all of a sudden God helps us. God helps us live the way that we should live. Sometimes we got to pray a lot. Sometimes we got to pray a whole lot. Sometimes we have to ask other people to pray for us. He's willing. God's willing to help us. Holy Spirit's willing to help us. Now, God cannot allow rebels into heaven. He just can't. As much as maybe he would like to, he can't. Rebels always recruit other people. You might remember the first time Eve sinned, the first thing she did, she went after Adam, recruited him. I remember several years ago, I was with a group of friends. I wasn't a Christian. And one of the girls started going to church. Well, a couple of the other girls went after her, so to speak. Got her to drink wine, trying to bring her back to the group. That's the way the rebels are. Always trying to recruit, always trying to get people to follow them. God can't allow them into heaven. Verse 8. Oh, bless our God, ye people, and make the voice of his praise to be heard. We are told to praise God. We are told to praise Christ and praise our great God. Now, does God need my praise? This great God who is creator of everything and has got angels and seraphim and who knows who else is out there, does he need my praise? I don't think he does. I think praise is for my benefit, our benefit, not for his benefit. Revelation 4:11. Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for thou hast created all things, and for thy pleasure they are and were created. The entire universe is called upon to praise God because he's worthy. The creator of everything, he's worthy of our praise. It gives us, people from all different walks of life, people from all different nations and nationalities, we can work together and praise God. We can pull together and praise God. People have nothing in common. All of a sudden, we got Jesus in common. All of a sudden, we got our Heavenly Father in common, and we are called upon to worship him and praise him. Verse 9. Which holdeth our soul in life, and suffereth not our feet to be moved. God protects us. God keeps us alive. Speaking of Jesus, Hebrews 1:3, who being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person and upholding all things by the word of his power. That's Jesus. That's Jesus Christ. Now, the James Webb telescope they've recently launched, it now tells us there's about 2 trillion galaxies out there. 2 trillion galaxies. Each one with billions and billions of stars. We have no idea how many planets, how many worlds are out there. But Jesus Christ created it all. And not only is he God the creator, he's God the sustainer. He sustains everything. I don't know how he does it, I just know he does. If somehow, some way, Jesus was to die, the whole universe would die too. Everything would be gone. Except for God the Father, God the Holy Spirit, of course. Jesus is the great creator, the great sustainer of all life. In verse 9 says, he suffers not our feet to be moved. In other words, when we're completely dedicated to him, and we're reading our Bibles much, and praying much, and striving to live the way he calls us to live, life never spins out of control. It may be really hard sometimes. It may be really, really hard sometimes. There may be things that I just seem to have no control over. But when we're committed to Him, the great King of the universe, life never spins out of control. In Psalms 94:18, when I said, my foot slippeth, thy mercy, O Lord, held me up. When we feel like we're slipping, when we feel like we can't make it, when we feel like we can't keep going, we tap into His power. His mercy holds us up. His mercy keeps us going. I remember a few years back, I guess it must have snowed or we had ice or something, and I was going outside to get the mail. And I stepped outside, stepped right on my driveway. I mean, I went down. I was just spinning, you know, everything's spinning out of control. I went all the way down the driveway. Fortunately, I ended up right in front of the mailbox. Worked out pretty well, I guess. But when we're committed to God, life never spins out of control. It's hard sometimes. It's really, really hard sometimes. But our Heavenly Father is there to help us, and we keep asking, and we keep praying, and He's going to keep answering. Verse 10. For thou, O God, hast proved us. Thou hast tried us as silver is tried. God is testing His people. We are being tested. God is working to reveal our hearts. Sometimes we don't know our own hearts. We think we're pretty good. We think we're rock solid. All of a sudden we find out we're not so good. We don't always understand our spouse's hearts or our kids' hearts. And God is working to reveal hearts so we can see who we are, what we're really all about, and we can know, do I need to really step it up spiritually or am I doing okay? Now, Judas. You might remember Judas. If on Passover week, okay, before the Last Supper and everything, Judas was walking down the street and a Roman chariot comes over and just floors him and kills him, what would we have thought? We would have thought, oh man, why did God allow that? Now, a great disciple has been killed, one of the best disciples of all times, and God allowed him to die. But as it played out, his heart was revealed. We saw who he really was, what he was all about. You might remember the book of Job, if you've ever read that. If Job ended at Job chapter 3, remember, first two chapters, Job's suffering horribly. His friends come from miles around, and they're there for him. I mean, they just come, they sit down, they try to comfort him, encourage him. And if it ends right there, we're thinking, Job, you are so blessed. You've got three of the greatest friends in history. But of course, it continued, and we saw a man with friends like that who needs enemies, right? What about Peter? Peter on the night of the crucifixion. He said, Jesus, I'm going to die for you. And if it ended right there, man, Peter, wow, he's pretty good. Found out an hour or two later he wasn't quite so good. So sometimes God has to allow things to play out. Why? How come Jesus hasn't come yet? Well, he's got to allow things to play out. Why am I suffering trials and troubles? Well, he's got to allow things to play out. Sometimes we don't know our own heart. Sometimes we think we're pretty good. God's up there saying, you're not as good as you think. He's trying to show us ahead of time so we can prepare and we can get ready, and we will be ready. Some Adventists, I'm faithful, and I'm going to be faithful when the time comes, and when the time of trouble's here, I'm going to be absolutely faithful, but they can't be faithful now. How are we ever going to be faithful then if we can't be faithful now? Now's still the time to learn, to grow, and to get ready for the days ahead. Zechariah 13:9. And I will bring the third part through the fire, and will refine them as silver is refined, and will try them as gold is tried. And they shall call on my name, and I will hear them. I will say, it is my people. They shall say, the Lord is my God. God has to show the universe who really loves him and who doesn't. Now, who's just along for the ride? I just want heaven. I don't really love God. Because heaven is too important to let rebels into heaven. Now, some might say, well, God already knows all that. Yeah, God does, but the angels don't. The beings out there, they do not. So God is working to reveal the hearts, who is really right with him. Now, God's children, they will stick by him when their job says, well, you better or you're fired. They'll stick by God no matter what. Now, I'm not saying we want to lose our jobs, just saying we'll stick by God no matter what. God's children, when the spouse says, you go to that church, I'm out the door, they're going to stick by God no matter what. I remember a certain gentleman, he came here once or twice, and I saw him at two or three other Adventist churches. And I talked to some of the people about him. Everyone told me the same thing. And this guy's kind of argumentative, and he's kind of cantankerous. He's not very much fun to deal with. Well, he called me up about a year or two ago, and he told me what was going on. He said, I was convinced that you guys were right, but my wife wasn't, and she didn't want to go to church on Saturday, and she didn't want to keep the Sabbath, and so I kind of compromised because of her. And now she's left me and divorced me, and I don't know what to do. God's people need to choose God even over their spouses. God's people choose God even when they have to go to jail for it. Didn't say we want to go to jail. Not saying we're holding out a sign, please take me to jail, but they choose God. God's people choose him even when they're going to die over it. 50 million people died during the Dark Ages because they chose God. God's people choose him. We got to choose him. We got to make sure no matter what happens, we choose him. No matter what we're facing, we choose him. It's not always easy. It's not always a good time. But through his help and his strength, he'll see us through. He'll get us through. 11 and 12. Thou broughtest into the net. Thou laidest affliction upon our loins. Thou hast caused men to ride over our heads. We went through fire and through water, but thou broughtest us out into a wealthy place. We suffered trial. We suffered tribulation. Life was really hard sometimes. People were really mean to us. We lost our job because of Christ. But when all is said and done, we had heaven. We had eternal life. I've heard the saying before, heaven is cheap enough. Heaven is cheap enough. No matter what we face, no matter what we go through, it's all worth it. Heaven is cheap enough. I remember I was 25, so that was, what, 3 or 4 years ago? Yeah. What are you laughing for? And I bought my first home. It was a first-time home buyer's loan, so I got a really good rate. And I remember I was dealing with the loan officer, a really good guy, and then somebody in training who's about my age, and he was telling me, yeah, this training, it's 7 days a week, and it's 12 hours a day, and this is really hard. And as he walked off, the other guy told me, you know, it'll be interesting to see if he makes it or not. It was hard training. It was tough training. But if you made it through the training, you had a really good job, pretty much guaranteed for life. And we're kind of in training right now. And we are going through tough times sometimes. And we're going through hard times. And sometimes we don't get what we want and it doesn't go how we want. Heaven is cheap enough. No matter what we face, for Jesus' sake, heaven is cheap enough. Isaiah 43:2. When thou passest through the waters, I will be with thee. And through the rivers, they shall not overflow thee. When thou walkest through the fire, thou shalt not be burned. Neither shall the flame kindle upon thee. We went through the waters, they almost drowned us, but they didn't. We went through the rivers, they almost blew us down the current, but they didn't. We went through the fire, it almost scorched us, but it didn't. And when all is said and done, God took us to heaven. When all is said and done, we went home with him for eternity. Heaven is cheap enough. Verse 13 and 14. I will go into thy house with burnt offerings. I will pay thee my vows, which my lips have uttered and my mouth has spoken when I was in trouble. He talks here about making vows to God. And some people, when they're in trouble, they make vows to God, promises to God. Now, get me out of this, God, I'll return a double tithe. get me out of this, God. I will go hand out 500, no, I'll go hand out 1,000 pieces of literature. Well, we got to keep our promises to God. God does not appreciate it when we promise him, I'll do this, and then we don't. I heard about a certain soldier, and he was under gunfire, promised God, I'll be a priest if you get me out of this. God got him out of it. He didn't want to be a priest. I don't know. I wouldn't make that kind of promise to the Lord. But when we promise God, we need to keep it. It's better off not to promise him than promise and not keep it at all. God is faithful to us. God is faithful to us. Are we faithful to him? God is as faithful to us as we are to him. And sometimes we wonder, well, God didn't seem to help me here. Well, were you faithful to him? God didn't seem to get me through this trial. Well, was I faithful to him? He's as faithful to us as we are to him. In Revelation 2:10, fear none of those things which thou shalt suffer. Behold, the devil shall cast some of you into prison that you may be tried. And ye shall have tribulation 10 days. Be thou faithful unto death, I will give thee the crown of life. What a great promise of God. Be faithful unto death. You'll get the crown of life. You'll have eternity. Next thing you know, you're going to see the face of Jesus. Verse 15 and 16. I will offer unto thee burnt sacrifices and fatlings with the incense of rams. I will offer bullocks with goats. Come and hear, all ye that fear God. I will declare what he hath done for my soul. In verse 16, here we have a testimony. We all have a testimony of what God has done for us. And we should share that testimony. Now, I'm not saying you need to go up to perfect strangers. I never met you in my life before. Can I share my testimony with you? I mean, you can. If that's your talent, then do it. But we should be sharing it at least with our family, at least with our church family, at least with our friends. We all have a testimony of what Christ has done for us. In Revelation 12:11, and they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, and they loved not their lives unto the death. We need to share our testimony, at least with somebody. Verse 17 to 19. I cried unto him with my mouth, and he was extolled with my tongue. If I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear me. But verily, God hath heard me. He hath attended to the voice of my prayer. Calling out to God for help. Calling out to God for strength. Calling out to God, help me through this time. See me through this terrible time. Psalms 34:15. The eyes of the Lord are upon the righteous, and his ears are open unto their cry. God hears the prayer of the righteous. Now, he doesn't necessarily hear the prayer of the church members, but he hears the prayer of the righteous, those who are striving to be righteous, striving to live righteously. He says, I hear your prayers. When we call out to him, he hears. When we're crying out to him, he hears. I don't always get this electric charge. Okay, I guess God heard. Sometimes it's total silence. God hears our prayers. We know it because he says he does. Here's our prayer. Proverbs 15:29. The Lord is far from the wicked, but he heareth the prayer of the righteous. In one sense, God's so far away from the wicked that he can't hear their prayers. God, give me a Corvette. God, I need $1 million. God, make this girl like me. He did in my case. God is so far from the wicked, he can't hear their prayers. He hears the prayer of the righteous. He hears our prayers. As we're calling out to him, crying out to him, Lord, I need help. I need strength. He hears. He's listening. Proverbs 15:8. The sacrifice of the wicked is an abomination to the Lord, but the prayer of the upright is his delight. It's his delight when we pray to him. It's not a burden. He's not up there saying, oh, is it you again? He delights to hear our prayers. He's glad when we take time to talk to him and listen to him. Verse 18 here. Cherished sin is a massive barrier to answered prayer. Sins that I cherish, that I'm not doing anything about, sins that I know I shouldn't do and I'm doing nothing about them, is a big barrier to him hearing and answering our prayers. Proverbs 28:9. He that turneth away his ear from hearing the law, even his prayer shall be an abomination. I know what the law says, but I'm not going to listen to that point. I know what it tells me to do, but 9 out of 10 is good enough. 8 out of 10 is good enough. When I first became an Adventist many years ago, my cousin, he started coming with me from time to time, and he knew what was right. He knew what was right. We studied it together and learned it together, a lot of it. And I remember one time he's telling me, well, I've kept the last 4 Sabbaths, and this Sabbath today is mine. That's the type of attitude that keeps God from hearing our prayers. I'm going to do what I want rather than what the Bible says. I know what God says, but I'm not going to do anything about that. Isaiah 59:1-2. Behold, the Lord's hand is not shortened that it cannot hear, neither that cannot save, neither is ear heavy that it cannot hear. But your iniquities have separated between you and your God, and your sins have hid his face from you that he will not hear. It's the sins that separate us from God. Now there's a difference. Okay, there's a big difference. Sins, I know this is wrong, and I'm really praying and really asking God for help and strength. I'm really trying to overcome this. I'm just not there yet. Okay, God can deal with that. God can forgive that because you're sincere in heart. That's not a problem. It's the sins that I know I shouldn't do this, and I'm going to do it anyway. I know I should do something about it, and I don't do anything about it. That covers God's ears, keeps him from hearing us. 1 John 3:22. And whatsoever we ask, we receive of him, because we keep his commandments and do those things that are pleasing in his sight. If this is us, he hears. He's answering. He's working. Do we always get what we want? No, of course not. Does that mean there won't be any trouble? No, of course not. It means he's there with us. He's going to help us every step of the way. Verse 20 as we close here. Blessed be God, which hath not turned away my prayer, nor his mercy from me. God does not turn away from us. Are we turning away from him? Let's pray as we close. And as we pray, if you felt some conviction and you know there's changes you need to make, I invite you to ask God to help you make the changes. Father, we pray. Lord, if there's things that we need to change, please help us change it. If there's things that we're just not dealing with, help us deal with it and help us love you with all of our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen.
Stand to sing our closing song, number 100. Great is our faith. Great is thy faithfulness.
Turning.
help us be as faithful to you as you are to us. In Jesus' name, amen.